Good morning, friends. It's Sunday morning. Welcome to Brother Mike's 9 a.m. podcast. We're on Pacific time now. Arizona and Pacific time are the same. Here in Arizona, we don't go to daylight saving time for one reason. We don't want to save any daylight. Man, it gets hot here in the summer. Professional heat. It's for real. And welcome to the broadcast. And thank you for tuning in. If you need to get a hold of me, you can contact me using my email. Mike@hardcorechristianity.com. You can, if you're here locally in Phoenix and you need prayer or you need to come in for a counseling appointment, we don't charge for counseling appointments if you're a born-again Christian. You can contact us on our ministry line, 602-636-5800. You can contact me on Facebook, Michael W. Smith. You can go to our Facebook group, Hardcore Christianity. And you can go to my other group, which is called Blessings, B-L-E-S-S-I-N-G-S, Blessings. And in that group, you'll be quite remarkably amazed. We post all of our miraculous healings and deliverances in that group, the Blessings group. So if you need somebody who needs to be encouraged or needs help, and they're down or discouraged, that is a great group to go to. Read some of those testimonies. I've got pictures of the people that were healed and delivered, and it'll help give people hope in the living Christ, who is today, obviously, still healing and delivering, just as he did in Palestine when he was here on the earth, doing much more of it now. So God wants you healed, and he wants you well. There's no question about that. The Bible's clear on it. And not everything happens at once, obviously. I have had several prayers in my life so far that have not yet been answered. But the key to being a disciple is someone who perseveres and lives a life of patient endurance. Okay? We don't get everything we want, and we don't get all of our prayers answered immediately. But trust me, all those prayers were heard, and the Holy Ghost already worked out your situation ahead of time. Friday night at the service, I had a remarkable teaching on leaving your life, old life behind. And I used the examples of the great father of faith, Abraham. I used another example, Moses. I used another example, Gideon. I used another example, Jeremiah. And these great men of God became great because they left their old lives behind. And that's what you've got to do in order to fulfill your destiny, in order for you to find out what you were put on this earth for, because every born again Christian has a destiny and has a God-given future, every single one of them. Even born again Christians who are disabled have a God-given destiny. The Holy Spirit wants to use each and every one of his children for something productive and powerful. And you are absolutely no exception. And there are no exceptions, period. He has something in mind for each person. Last Friday night at the service, we ran out of sick people again. We need you to send us more sick people. A gentleman, his daughter came up to me at the altar call Friday night and said, hey, my dad's got two bad knees. So I talked to the guy for a minute, and he wore his knees out from a long career in construction. He was like my age, an old man, and his knees, both of his knees were killing him. He was kind of hobbling as he walked. So I, you know, led him in a repentance prayer. He used to be a bouncer. That's a horrible, sinful occupation. So I led him in a repentance prayer over being a bouncer, and I grabbed both of his knees with my hands and prayed over him. And then I said, okay, go ahead and walk. Guy turned around, started walking back and forth up at the altar. You can watch it on YouTube if you want to. Go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. You can hear me on the YouTube. You can hear what I said to him. You could probably hear what he said to me if you're interested. And the guy had a look on his face like, Wow, I can't believe it. He was grinning and everything. His knees were healed. Another woman walked up to me, a very strange situation. 2 days before that, I was talking to Brother Rick Catt, and he's been having phenomenal success on his Wednesday night Zoom service. That's at 6 o'clock Pacific time, 9 p.m. Eastern. If you go to the Zoom service every Wednesday night, you'll see some remarkable deliverances on there. What he was telling me about somebody who was on the Zoom service who was a gypsy. Well, last Friday night, a woman walked up to me. She came down to the altar, and I started to pray. No one was praying for her, and I started praying, and spirits started coming out of this woman, and she was dressed. She looked exactly like a gypsy. I thought she was a gypsy. I guess she was from out of state. She didn't live in Arizona. She had come from out of state and came to the service with her dad. Well, this woman went through an enormous deliverance. She must have had a legion of spirits in her. And after I was done with the altar call, I went to the bathroom. When I went into the bathroom, there was a guy in there on one of those seated walkers. The walkers you have where there's a seat in them so you could walk for a little bit and then rest. And when I was going to the bathroom, he left. So when I got out of the bathroom, I saw he was in the kitchen. So I went in the kitchen to talk to him. I said, why did you come to the service tonight? What happened to you? How come you're hauling a walker around? He said, well, I have some kind of forgot the name of it. It was a vascular disease. And his right leg was numb and his right arm was numb. And he couldn't walk but a few steps here and there anymore. And he had to use a walker and sit down a lot and so on. I said, well, do you mind if I pray for it? He said, okay. So I prayed a short prayer for him. I grabbed his right leg. I grabbed his arm. I said, Lord Jesus, have mercy. I said, okay, that's it. Now go ahead. So I took him out of the kitchen. And he started walking up and down the halls of the deliverance center. The guy was completely shocked. Couldn't believe it. He was healed. And then I posted pictures of both those people on my Facebook page, Michael W. Smith, and put a little caption there telling you what had happened to the guy. But years and years ago, when I was 19 years old, that was a long time ago. I'm almost 70 now. When I was 19 years old, our family, and I don't even know how this happened, I can't remember anymore, found out that a woman, a lady preacher from Pittsburgh named Kathryn Kuhlman, was going to be at the Mabee Center at Oral Roberts University in Tulsa on a certain date. I think it was a Saturday. And I don't even remember how this happened, but somehow I decided to go. And I took my girlfriend with me, and we went to Kathryn Kuhlman. My mom went, my best friend went, and my dad went, and I went, and my girlfriend went. Five of us went. And it took 6 hours to drive to Tulsa from my hometown of Emporia, Kansas. That's where I went to college. I went to Emporia State University for my bachelor's and my master's degree. And after that, I started a 25-year career as a secular counselor. And we drove 6 hours to the Mabee Center. We got there, and the parking lot was almost full. And we got there 2 hours before the doors opened, 2 hours before the service started. The place was almost full. Well, my parents got in line. There was a long line already to get into this building. The building seated 16,000 people, including the folding chairs on the floor on the basketball court. They had filled up the whole center. It's the basketball, maybe center, the basketball center. And I was standing out in front, and while I was standing in the parking lot, I was watching buses coming into this facility, literally from 2, 3, 4, 5 states away. And this went on for 2 hours. And every one of the buses, every single one of them, I didn't find one empty seat. It looked like every bus was completely full. And I remember at 19 years of age thinking to myself, what in the world is everybody coming here to see a female preacher from Pittsburgh? How can this possibly be happening? Who is coming here to see this woman and this many people? Well, two hours went by and we got into the facility, and then we had to wait another hour for the service to start. Then a guy came out wearing looked like a tuxedo. This guy was an excellent pianist. And I think the guy's name was Dino something. I don't remember the last name. I couldn't pronounce it. And I mean, this guy was, no question, a great pianist. They came out and sang some worship songs to Jesus. They, had a couple other things going on, a couple of announcement situations. And then suddenly the curtain pulled back like this. And there was this woman from Pittsburgh standing there, just standing there. And kind of some kind of awe went through the building. And I remember I felt it. I started crying for no reason. I was just staring at her, and I was utterly amazed at what I was looking at. We had traveled 6 hours. I had been out in front of the building for 2 hours. I'd been in the building for an hour. Then I'd been in the service like for an hour. And then suddenly there she is. And I remember thinking how odd she looked. She was elderly. She looked like she was in her 70s, mid 70s. She was about, I'm going to say 5'6", maybe five, something like it. Very skinny, very homely looking, very unattractive, had terrible looking hair. And she looked like she was wearing a nightgown, kind of a gangly woman, very unattractive, no cosmetic appeal whatsoever. And I'm mesmerized now. I cannot believe. I looked around the auditorium. I looked clear up in the balconies. I looked behind me. I was down on the floor about 20 or 25 rows up, and I had an aisle seat. And every seat in the facility was taken. Every seat was filled. And here is this woman from Pittsburgh, very unattractive person. And then she started talking. You wouldn't even have believed it to hear her. She had a very strange pitch and tone and mannerism of speaking. Very unusual. And again, to make a longer story short, if you want to hear more details about what happened that day, go to my YouTube teaching channel, youtube.com/houseofhealingaz, and pull up the video, Brother Mike Meets Kathryn Kuhlman. And it's kind of a fun video to watch. I cried my way through it and laughed my way through it. You'll get a lot of giggles out of it. It was a very, very unusual trip, and a lot of funny little things happened. Brother Mike Meets Kathryn Kuhlman. And I sat there and watching her talk, and a very poor speaker, not a preacher of any kind whatsoever, very plain type person. She was from Missouri. Everything about the entire day, including the trip, left me utterly amazed. I was 19 years old then. And when you're 19 years old, you think you're intelligent. You think you understand everything. You think you're the boss of the world, and you think you'll live forever. And later on, I realized everything I thought when I was 19 was wrong. Everything I believed when I was 19 was false. I was not intelligent. I was not going to live forever. I was just, the whole thing was the scam of your youth. You think you're something you're not. Well, I'm standing there at the baby center, and I cannot believe my eyes. I cannot believe what I'm hearing. I can't believe what I'm seeing. Well, at the end of the service, again, I'm skipping a lot of stuff. You'll see it in the video if you want more details. But at the end of the service, it was time for prayer. And everybody stands up. You know, 16,000 people were all on her feet. And she's up there standing in the center of the stage and says something like, Dear Jesus, I don't have a thing tonight. Why aren't my eyes there? I could not believe I heard that. I traveled 6 hours from Kansas. I had been standing out in front for 2 hours. I had been in the building for an hour. I'd been through the service for an hour. Then she had come out. That was another hour. And she doesn't have a thing. I mean, I don't even know what's going on. And then she prays a short prayer. I can't remember what she said. It's been obviously a long time ago, but I don't recall what she was praying. And then she went stone silent. And it was utterly amazing. I've never seen anything like it before or since, obviously, but the whole auditorium was stone quiet. You could have heard a pin drop in that stadium. It was amazing. No one was, it's almost like nobody was breathing. And then in about a minute to 2 minutes from her ending that prayer, whatever it was, I start hearing things literally all over the auditorium, every balcony, every section, way in the back. I'm more toward the front on the ground level. They're way in the back. I hear moanings. I hear people crying. I heard somebody scream. I heard clanking. I heard people rustling. I heard people weeping. What I didn't know was I was listening to what Jesus talked about in John chapter 3 about the Holy Ghost, that you can see the wind's results, but you can't see the wind. And I saw the results of an invisible person who, at that moment, I sensed was God Almighty moving through that auditorium. And one person after the other, I could not count them, were being healed. And I was looking around in a state of shock, watching and listening to what was going on. Could not believe anything I was seeing. I finally sat down and I was crying. I kept crying. And for some reason, I heard a clanking or something way behind me down the aisle. I was sitting right on the aisle. This was way down my aisle, clear in the back. There was a wheelchair section back there. And there was a bunch of clanking and things going on back there. And I was curious about it, so I turned around and looked. I looked back, and I saw a guy walking down toward the stage. And at this time, Kathryn had said something to the effect of, now, if you've been healed and you know you're healed or something, come up to the front and give your testimony. Well, within 10 minutes, there were people lined up all the way down on the right side, all the way down on the left side, people standing up left and right. I could not believe my eyes, but I turned behind me and looked, and I saw a guy coming out of the wheelchair section down my aisle, headed down to the front to give his testimony. And the closer he got to me, the more shocked I was. He looked like Someone dug him up. It was clear and obvious he had been a quadriplegic because he had pencils for legs and pipe cleaners for arms. He was skin and bones. He looked like a patient that they found at Auschwitz at the end of World War II when they raided the concentration camps. This guy looked like death warmed over, and the closer. The closer he got to me, I could see a look on his face of he was like shocked. And I saw he had tears pouring out of both eyes. And he was kind of walking with an altered gait in a way. You could tell the guy had been sitting in a wheelchair, not a couple of weeks, but I mean years. He'd been stuck in a wheelchair. His body was literally gone. And he come down the aisle, walked right past me, a foot from me, walked right past me. And to this day, I've never forgotten. And what happened in the service Friday night to that guy's knees and to that other guy's vascular condition was simply a fraction, an invisible fraction of the incredible power of the Holy Ghost. What I saw that day, I've never seen before. I've never seen since. Several years ago, I was in Tijuana, Mexico, and I'd gone there with Rick Catt, who's on our ministry team. He does the Zooms Wednesday night, as I mentioned. He also teaches Thursday nights. That's our best deliverance service of the week. It's phenomenal. Thursday nights at 7 o'clock Pacific time. That's also on YouTube. Well, I went down with the Rick Catt. We had gone down there because a minister friend of ours, his name was Joshua Fierstein. He's a big social media guy now. He moved to Texas. But back in those days, Fierstein was kind of like a traveling preacher, so to speak, and he was living in Arizona. And he had gone down to Tijuana to hold some crusades. And he wanted us to come down there and help him with doing altar work. I said, okay, we'll do that. So we did. We went down there to work the altar for him. And I don't know if you know Joshua Fierstein. This guy can preach the paint off a house. I'm telling you, this guy's got the gift of preaching, if there is such a gift. This guy can preach like you can't believe. Well, we were at the downtown auditorium in Tijuana, and it was, as you can imagine, kind of a dump. Much of that whole city is a dump. But there's a lot of it that's fixed up and it looks just like, you know, like San Diego. You know, they get a lot of tourists down there and they have a lot of nice areas in Tijuana. And then, of course, they have a lot of ratty areas. They didn't have any building codes down there for obvious reasons. So this auditorium we were in, if they'd had an earthquake, this thing would have come down. It seated about, I think they said it seated 6,000 people. And it was, I think it was a double decker. You know, kind of a dome thing. And there was a big stage down in front, and a bunch of churches from Tijuana were supporting the crusade. And Fierstein, it was a two-night crusade, and Fierstein preached the first night, and he preached a house on fire. It was amazing. He had a translator up there, and it was incredible. Well, I felt the anointing fall in that service. I mean, I thought it was huge. And I had never been at an altar call before or since with that kind of anointing. When Fierstein got through and he led the people to come down to the front to get born again, we got the signal from somebody to go start praying for the people. So I walked out there into the crowd and started praying for people, and the Holy Ghost was so powerful. I would sweep my hand over two or three people. They would fly backwards and fall on the ground. I would rebuke spirits in groups, and the demons would be flying out of the people. I mean, bodies were flying everywhere. People were breaking down all over the place, crying their eyes out, weeping their way into the kingdom of God. It was phenomenal. And as you can imagine, you know, in my condition now, not when I was 19 and didn't know nothing from nothing. Now, just a few years ago, I knew what I was doing. I was in hog heaven. I could not believe how happy I was. I took advantage of that like you would not believe. I stayed there till late at night casting demons out of Mexicans. I skipped dinner. Everybody else went to the taco Mexican places, the crusade team. They were all gone. I stayed there till the last dog got hung. I was there. Bodies were laying all over the floor. Families were coming to me for prayer. I took advantage of everything that happened. The exact same thing happened the next night, only, check this out, the local ministers there saw what I was doing the night before and what Rick was doing, blowing the devils out of everybody. So then they got the idea they could do it, which was great. That's what you're supposed to do. You see somebody else doing something, you go, hey, the Holy Spirit can use me too. Well, I saw them doing it. And I thought, well, I'm not going to go out there and do that again. They got this covered. So I went over to the section on the right side where the parents had brought people who were sick and disabled or ill, or their children were sick or what have you. And I spent my whole time over there at the altar call that night, the second night, which was the last night of the crusade. And then after I left that section there, I stayed till the bitter end. Again, casting demons on people all over the place, the people that had stayed, the crusade was long over. I was still there casting spirits out of people and praying for sick people. It was phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. But what I wanted to tell you was, and I said all that to say this, at this time, the Holy Ghost is starting to make his big move. There's a deliverance revival going on all around the country. A movie came out, Come Out in Jesus' Name. People were getting delivered from demons in the theater, okay? Rick Catt went to the movie over at the Camelback Esplanade in Phoenix. And at the end of the movie, they went into the group deliverance thing. And he started casting demons out of people everywhere in his section. He was picking up popcorn boxes and using them for buckets. And it was amazing. It happened right there in the theater. And all over the country, there's a deliverance revival going on. There's Ashbury breaking out. The Holy Ghost is moving in colleges. And everything that goes on, of course, none of it goes perfectly. And the people that are involved, the vast majority of them are flawed people like me. You know, they got problems and they're not perfect and they say things that are not right, like me, and they screw up, like me. Everybody in the system is flawed and imperfect. There was only one person that wasn't flawed in history. I think you know his name. Did you get it? Okay. There's only one person that wasn't flawed. That, of course, was the great Son of God, the Son of the living God. But the point is this, the Holy Ghost sees the devil. He took over America. He's in charge now. And the Spirit of God's not going to sit there and do nothing. It's not going to happen. He is going to come back, and what he's going to do, he's going to get a can of whoop ass and open it up on the devil, and he's going to fight back, and there's going to be blowback you won't believe coming from the Spirit of God. Well, I said all that, Kathryn Kuhlman, I said all that, Tijuana, I said all that Friday night at the Deliverance Center. I said all that to say this, you are to be a part of this, the last move of God before the rapture and the tribulation. We've only got a couple of years left and it's going to be over. It's time for you to get rid of your old baggage. Don't be like Abraham. He brought Lot with him. Don't be like Moses. He made one excuse after the other not to fulfill his destiny. Don't be like Jeremiah. and think you grew up in a bad family and you're unworthy and your family tree is a bunch of idiots, forget about it. God is calling you. Okay? Don't be like Gideon. He was like Jeremiah. He thought he lived among a bunch of people who were morons, a bunch of people who were unqualified. He came from a family tree that was nuts. So he made excuses not to fulfill his destiny. Don't you do it. Did you come from a dysfunctional family? Good. Are your parents crazy? Are your parents crazy? Good. Good. God is calling you because of it. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Don't make an excuse that you are not to be part of this final move of God. This thing's going to be huge. The Holy Ghost isn't going to sit here and watch America go right down the toilet. He's going to fight back. And when he fights back, nobody can stop him. You know that. No one can take him. No one has a chance against him. It's ridiculous. He's so ahead of the devil and Satan. It's not even funny. It's a joke. Comparing him to anybody is a joke. If you have a sentence and you end it with the Holy Ghost, the conversation stops there. It's over. That's a mic drop moment. The Spirit of God representing the Lord Jesus, 100%. 100%. He cannot be stopped. And as Kathryn Kuhlman once said, and I'll quote her for you. And as I said, nobody could have been more inappropriate for the ministry than Kathryn Kuhlman. Okay. I saw it with my own eyes. Nobody can talk me out of it. You can't do it in a million years. I was there. I saw it. Yeah, I was confused. I was skeptical. I was young. I thought I knew what I was doing. Just like you. You think you know what you're doing. You do not. You are called by God. You are worthy to be called by God through the blood of Christ. You are to fight with fury in these last days. We've only got a few years left. In my personal opinion, the Antichrist and the false prophet are alive somewhere on the planet Earth right now. They're probably in middle school or something. They're junior high. I don't know how far it is off, but I know we got very little time left. You can clearly see it. You can clearly see what's happening. The end is coming. And the end requires you to be a servant and a mover and a conduit of the great Holy Ghost. And if you happen to be like Kathryn Kuhlman, and you're an unattractive person, and you sound funny, and you got a weird looking body, and you're unattractive, and you got strange hair, and you wear strange clothes, and you appear weird, okay? Do you meet any of those qualifications? Good. Good for you. Congratulations. Well done. You are now set up. You are in line for the outpouring of the great Holy Ghost, the one and only. God wants to heal these people. He wants to save them. He's reaching out into movie theaters to rub the devil's nose in it. He is going to whip him like a dog. And God wants you to pick up your Holy Ghost whip and get out there and make him pay. Let's put it this way. You got a score to settle. And we all got scores to settle. The devil has raped and ruined and robbed you, your family, your relative. Look what he did to your parents. Look what he's done to your siblings. Look at them all. They're all on drugs. They all have babies out of wedlock. They're all suffering from depression and anxiety. Look what he's done to your family. Look what he did to you when you were young. Kicked your face in and then rubbed your nose in it in the backyard. You're going to get some payback. That's what you're going to do. Yeah, it's payback time. Let me leave you with this, if I may. Kathryn said something weird. She said that God wasn't looking for golden vessels. And God's not looking for silver vessels. He's looking for yielded vessels. And that would be you.